in the inside cover of your hymnal or on the screen above me, and we'll repeat this in unison in one voice. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Another great discipline of the Reformed faith is a time of confession and repentance. So at this time, we will take a moment of silence to pray for our own repentance and forgiveness as we confess to our Creator. Let us pray. Father, I pray that we will never take for granted the fact that you have promised that you are a God who is near to us, not a God who is far away. And that, Lord, as Jesus surrendered his life on the cross, when he said, "It is finished," the veil was torn and we had access to you, to the holies of holies. So that it is with honor and respect and love and adoration that we come to you, Lord. We ask for your forgiveness. Lord, we pray for the strength to turn away from those things, that we may live a life that is worthy of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And it's in his name we pray. Amen. Friends, the Bible is very clear that when we confess our sins are forgiven. So it is through the power of the resurrection of Jesus Christ we can declare our sins are forgiven. Let's stand now and sing the glory of Patri. Amen. Let us remain standing to sing our next hymn, hymn number 466, Take My Life and Let It Be.
Thank you.
Amen. You may be seated. Normally at this time, I'd come out and tell a great story about the ministry of Cornerstone, but Gabe's going to recap that so beautifully today. So at this time, let's just collect our morning tithes and offerings. Let us join together in prayer. Father God, we thank you. Lord, for everything we have in this world, we have because you have blessed us richly. And Father, when we think about the fact that you give us 100%, and that you ask for us to joyfully give back 10% in honor and reverence to you and in love and adoration for you. So Father, it is with joyful hearts that we give this morning. Lord, we ask that you would pour a blessing and an anointing upon these gifts and offerings, they'd be used to bring glory and honor to your name, to reach this community with the love of Jesus Christ. So, Father, we thank you for this time. We thank you for every heart that is here and every heart that gave. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Thank you. Amen. Whew. All right. So I'm breaking two of the three top rules you're never supposed to do when introducing a new series in the church. And number one is no one other than the lead pastor, according to the textbook, should ever start off a new series. And I said, well, that's great. We're going to have Gabe do it, which led me to number two. You're never supposed to mess up the order. And the order is Gabe's doing number four in the original series because it just works perfectly. And we wanted to hear from Gabe sooner rather than later. We're doing a new series called Top Priorities. A few years ago, our elders got together and we said, what are the four pillars of Cornerstone? If there was four pillars that we wanted the church to be known for, we said they were worship, grow, serve, and reach. So that'll be the series coming up. But we're going to start with reach because we had an amazing opportunity to send one of our elders to Uganda to do ministry. And Gabe's going to report back, share with that. But it's so much more than what happened in Uganda. Gabe's heart was changed. And anyone who's talked to him since he's been back, we see that new zealousness for what God's doing. So Gabe, at this time, if you want to come over and take over, that'd be great.
Thanks, Steve. Good morning. I guess we're going rogue this morning. So that's cool. Jesus was kind of a rogue the way he was, wasn't he? So that's all right. So I want to just say thank you, first of all, for all the support that you guys gave to me and to our ministry. Going to Uganda, and it's an honor to stand here and share that with you. And I'm also excited about the future of what we can do there, if so led. And that's really the key, if so led to do so. But I'm gonna talk also about reach, as Steve just mentioned. Pastor Steve just mentioned. You know, it's all about us listening and going out and sharing. So. Next slide, please. So when we went to Uganda, obviously something I know I shared with a lot of you before. That was something that I had never done before. I've never been overseas. The furthest I've been is Canada. So I decided to go halfway around the world. Why not? And you guys, it was just an amazing experience. For me, and I didn't go over there trying to be the American that knows everything and I'm going to help change the world. I tried to take a humble approach to it and go over there and say, and learn and just be a student of them and their culture. And so if you guys can go to the next slide, that'd be great. So God has a heart for all nations. And it's not just the United States. It's not just for the white people, right? It's not just for Christians even. It is all nations. That's what it says in the scripture. And when we have words that are absolute, like all and every, we need to pay attention to that. And one thing that really, I think, was impressed upon me is that we are all, each and every one of us in this world, are God's kids. And so Acts 1:8 says, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. So what that meant at that time is Jesus is saying, in your backyard, across the river, and across the world is where you will be strong for me in the Holy Spirit. When you go and speak spiritual conversations with people, we reach people that way. And I'm going to talk about their culture a lot today, because that was a big part of, you know, you think about how Jesus interacted with the people in where he was and at the time that he was in. It was mostly cultural. And when you study scripture, if you understand the culture, you understand the message even more. It's a big part of reading the Bible. And so, thinking about talking, just a normal conversation with somebody, wasn't that hard. But the spiritual conversation that happens shortly thereafter is much easier in some ways, when you can have just a regular conversation, be opening and be friendly, and it's powerful. We don't have to know all the words to say. We don't have to read the Bible from beginning to the end. We just have to love Jesus, and we just have to have a conversation. And God is going to take care of the rest. That was a big part of what I was nervous about before I went. And we can go to the next slide. One of the things I was nervous about was trying to do more, like me trying to do it. But, you know, I was with this guy, Paul Ford, Dr. Paul Ford. He's a very, many of you may know Dr. Paul Ford. He's been here a few times. He's a missionary. He's been all over the world, places like Azerbaijan and Turkey and Ukraine, Russia, and he's been discipling people all over the world. And Uganda is a place that he's been about 20 times. And so one of the things he said to me was very powerful was, you don't have to do anything. You just have to be there and let God take care of the rest. Because the Holy Spirit really does work. He works. And so that was a very impactful part of the whole thing for me. I was a little nervous because, you know, you guys showed me a lot of support. And I wasn't nervous because of that. That emboldened me to do the work that I did there. But what I was nervous about is that a lot of you gave a lot for me to go. And I wanted to make sure that I did right by that. But see, the problem is that I said I. I didn't say God or we. You know, that's the huge part there. The other gentleman in this photo I want to mention is Sam Abuku. Sam, I'm going to talk about a little bit later, but I wanted to introduce you to him because he is an amazing man, and an amazing man in God, of God. And the things that he did and does and will do are very, very noteworthy. And next slide. And so he met me, and a couple of other people met us at the airport in Entebbe. Entebbe is way down in the very south. That big lake at the south of the map is Lake Victoria. For those of you that know your geography a little bit, this is the country of Uganda, by the way. And so way down south in the very south central part of Uganda is where we landed. And it took us about 8 hours to drive from. After we got off the plane, I was on the plane for about 22. And then we got off and drove 8 hours. And we went to this little red area, which is the Teso, in the Teso region, which is a tribal region in east central Uganda. And that, the village I was in the bush is called Komode. So the village of Komode in east central Uganda. And I wanted to add this little photo of this little guy. And he's a really cute little dude. And he's dressed in what would kind of be a normal festive dress. His mom was wearing something very, very colorful. She's in the background. His grandma was back there. She's in the background. Hard to see, I know. But, you know, one thing that was really surprising about their culture is they have very little. I think you probably all realize that they have very little. But they dress very well. And I thought that was fascinating because they'll be wearing button-up shirts, dress pants, dress shoes. That's cross culture in this area, especially because I think they take pride in representing themselves and how they look. They have very good hygiene. You know, we can't drink the water there, but before you get a tea or whatever it might be, they make sure it's boiled. It's really quite impressive how they handle themselves, I think, just in everyday life. Next slide. But that little guy was cute. And I want to talk about I'll talk a little bit about the demographics of Uganda, because that's important as well. I was welcomed with open arms. Literally, when I got off the plane, the first thing that I got was like three different hugs from people I'd never met in my life, which can make a guy a little uncomfortable if you're not used to that. But thankfully, I'm okay with that because I have Dave Kenner in my life. And that's Carly's uncle. He's a hugger. But one of the culture of kindness is so strong there, because wherever we went, we had a meal. And poverty is everywhere. They eat in the region that we were in, they eat. But the first thing that they would do is they would offer you a table full of food, including meat. And that's something that they don't normally eat every meal, is meat. Most of the time it'll be beans for their protein, and that's it. But they welcomed me. And one thing we talked about was posturing yourself. And the Christian faith is about posturing. It's a part of it. Posturing yourself, you know, sometimes when you go to different cultures, you might receive a posture similar to this. You know, what I experienced was a posture like this, where conversations were kind, gentle, and they were open. And so that made everything so much easier. And when you talk about sharing the word and, you know, being open and posturing yourself that way, it makes everything so much easier. John 13:20 says, "I assure you, whoever receives anyone I send receives me. And the one who receives me receives him who sent me." And I never forget sitting in the pews at various churches, and you would see the painting of Jesus standing at the door, and he would be knocking. And that's what I think about when I read that scripture. We need to be open to open the door. Next slide. These are just some photos of some of the experiences that I had. Food, again, everywhere. We went on an agricultural tour of a farm, and this top left-hand picture was, you know, almost like a banquet that we got when we walked in. And this is outside. They just had a little lean-to with a thatch roof, and we sat down, and we had the best tea I've ever had in my life, and the food was really, really good. It wasn't bad. Although, if you skip over to the top right corner, I don't know if you can see that, but that's chicken, and the chicken's claw is still in there, and you can eat that. That's a delicacy. So I did not partake in the chicken claw, but there was a lot of really great food. And again, that's something that they don't do that all the time. We eat banquets every day, sometimes multiple times a day. Generally, we'd wake up in the morning and we would just sit around this little table in the bottom right-hand corner, and that was at a compound near Barnack High School, which I'll talk about in just a moment. And, you know, we had a lot of great conversation around that table, prepared for the day with prayer, and we ate a lot of matoka, which is a staple food there, matoka, and ground nut gravy, which is basically like peanuts that they just ground up and turn into a gravy. And it's not that bad, but a lot of food. Next slide. The hospitality, as I go on one more slide here, the hospitality, you can see the old gentleman there. He was the Messiah. He was the old man that everyone respects and reveres. And, you know, in this culture, when you have an elder, and he's 87 years old, and he lives in the bush in a hut, and he's done that for 87 years. He remembers the British Commonwealth. He remembers the changeover. He remembers when, and I'll talk about this tribe in a little bit, the Karamoja came down to the Ateso region and pillaged and stole and burned, and he remembers all that. It's pretty amazing. And those two elderly women are also in their 80s. And so the demographic in Uganda, if the top would be the older generation, there are very few. And as you get down into younger years, it starts to widen out, which generally they do. But most of the time when you see an average country, it'll widen out at the bottom just, you know, maybe about halfway. There are many, it widens out so much, there are many, many, many young children. There's been a population boom over the last 20 years. So the ages from in their early 30s down to infants is very big. They have to feed all those kids. And that's a challenge. Next slide. This is where I stayed. This is the hut that I lived in right here for my 7 days in Uganda. And So I lived in a, they had a bed there for me, and I had a mosquito net because malaria is pretty prevalent. And in fact, when we were there, Sam got malaria right as I was leaving. I hadn't mentioned that to anybody. So he was pretty sick. There was a thatch roof on this that the rats lived in. And so you could hear the rats at 3 a.m. in the morning. And like at about 3 o'clock in the morning, they'd be squeaking at me. One thing we talked about was just the ability for me to get into this culture. This is a remote area, and I was fairly comfortable. And I think I would venture to guess that a lot of you would be pretty comfortable too, because we live in that kind of a culture here in North Dakota, where we have a rural setting, we're friendly to one another, we support one another, we welcome people into our homes, we have meals together. And, you know, well, that was really something that I thought about a lot, was because they don't do that everywhere in our culture in the United States. And so we don't want to lose that. We want to hang on to that. That's important. Next slide. This is Solomon and Brenda. They're who I stayed with. They're in their early 30s. Solomon is the director of Barnack School, and he makes about $850 US a year. So that's just unbelievable if you can wrap your brain around being able to live off of that and go to school from 7 in the morning until 5 at night and then go home and tend to your crops or your livestock because you're a subsistence farmer. And so you have to raise everything you eat. That's a hard life. Brenda owns a little tea shop that she opens and runs when she can, and there's 6 or 7 items on her menu. One of which is water, tea, Simpson balls. I don't know if you've ever heard of those, but they're just a really like hard cracker type of ball, and just they tasted terrible. But I enjoyed the company in that place. It was a pretty amazing time. Next slide. Just the fact that she's able to have this little tiny shop. And I'm going to talk about entrepreneurship in a little bit, because that's a big part of this trip that we were on. I was able to sit down and meet with some school staff and give them some words of encouragement, because for those of you that don't know, I work in education, and when I sat down, up in the top right-hand corner is the elementary school, they call it primary school, teachers. They had never had anybody come to them and speak from anywhere outside of their school. And some of them have been working there for a while. And it's hard to stay motivated as a teacher, because kids come and go. Their parents want them to be in education. They value education, much unlike the United States. And when they can't pay for their kids to go to school anymore, the school has no choice but to send those kids home. And eventually they get enough money and they'll send those children back to school, but they've missed a lot. That's a challenge for the Ugandan people. But education is highly sought after. So it's hard to want to stay in education. So I spoke to them about the fig tree. And that's a scripture in Luke. And it reminded me of my educational experiences too. Where you just have those tough kids. And you don't know what to do with them. And you just want to let them go. You want to cut them loose. But the fig tree parable said, the owner of the fig tree wanted it cut down by the gardener. The gardener said, no, wait for a year. We need to give it time. We have to let it have a chance to grow. And that's what education here is all about. These are Christian schools. And even state-run schools are Christian schools in Uganda. 83 to 85% are Christian in this country. We talked about grace, patience, and nurturing. They've never had a professional development in their life. Next slide. That was a great time. This is another ministry. This was kind of a heartbreaker. All these girls in this photo, the teachers are in the front, and behind that, these are all females that have had babies. They're all teenage mothers. And in Uganda, the culture is one that kicks these women out of the family when they have a child out of wedlock. And so There's a story about a young lady named Grace who literally had her baby and literally lived in a gutter for a couple of months and had nowhere to go and ended up getting to come to Barnack School and being supported by somebody and learning tailoring and getting a sense of self-worth, knowing that she's worth it, that these people will spend time for them. But more than just the people, it's about finding their self-worth in Christ and knowing that they're forgiven, because it's all about grace. And I will guarantee you, not one of these girls will give sanction to their behavior, but they all are coming to terms with it and realizing that they're worth it. If we confess our sins, he is faithful in our righteousness to forgive and righteousness to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. You've heard that many times. This is what these girls are coming to terms with, that they're not garbage, that they're not just unworthy, and that they're going to hell, that we love them, that there's grace in their lives, and they can continue on and be worth much more than they'll ever understand. Next slide. The young girl on the left gave a 4-page speech explaining where she was and where she is now today in Christ. It was a powerful thing. But you can see the joy in her face now. A lot of these women bring their children with them and sit and do tailoring while their children are there, because there's no child care. Next slide. There's 25 of them and 12 machines. So when they go, they might only get the machine for half the time and they look over somebody else's shoulder. And you'll see that this is outside. They don't have a classroom. They do all of their sewing outside. So they move the machines from inside the building outside and they do their tailoring. So that's a challenge during certain times of the year. When the wind is there, when the rainy season comes, they have nowhere to go. That's one thing we hope to do, is maybe build a classroom for them. Next slide. This is Green Valley Primary School. There's 60 students in a classroom, second graders. We went into the second grade classroom, 60 kids. And this is their desks that they use. This is Paul, along with Moses and his two children that he supports. Next slide. And when we got there, I don't know if this video is going to play or not, but there was a video of the kids singing. And so that was really something I wanted to share with you, but we'll have to do that at a different time, I guess. Next slide, I think, unless it plays. Yeah. So at the primary school, they all met me. I walked in, and there were 100 kids in this room, and they started singing when I walked in. It was a really special moment. At Barnack School, another amazing moment later on in that day, I stood outside, and it was 80-some degrees, and we sat in the shade of this monstrous tree. I don't even know what kind of tree it was. And there was 100 students, and me, and all the staff. And I just encouraged the students that I read from 1 Thessalonians about taking care of yourself, not being a burden on anyone else, doing the best you can for your own education, and understanding that they have an opportunity in the Lord to better themselves. Sometimes I think that would be pretty amazing to be able to say that to our students as well. But next slide. Encouraging young people is an important thing that needs to be done here too, because they have a lot of trial, because there's so many people that don't eat. They made instruments on their own in school and they played them for us. Unfortunately, it's not working, so we'll just go to the next slide. This is Sam, and he's in a field. And Sam and Toto Abuku, Sam is this guy I introduced you to earlier. He's a bishop with PAG, it's called Pentecostal Assemblies of God. 5,000 churches in Uganda. This guy is one of the main people out of those 5,000 churches. He's like a national celebrity. Almost everybody knew this guy wherever we went. But his call changed in his life. He gave all of that up, being the bishop of the PAG churches, to go to Karamoja, northern Uganda, to sleep on a mat in a dung hut and feed people and spread the word of the Lord. Amazing testimony. And one thing about the Karamoja is they're not I mean, they're great people, but their culture is one of being warriors. And so if you have cattle, you are constantly in fear of them coming and taking your cattle and killing you, of breaking into your home and stealing everything you have. That's their culture. It's embraced in this area. This is the Karamoja region. I was in the Atesso region. So this tribe of the Karamojong are very dangerous. He is making cultural change there, using the word of the Lord and working in a hospital there. They feed 250 to 400 people in this hospital every single day. And what they feed them is porridge only. They don't make meals other than this porridge. It's like a huge vat. It's got millet, silverfish, which is like a shrimp almost. And it's high nutrition because there's so much malnutrition. There was a story of a two-year-old that walked 4 miles from his home with 3 cups the size of a coffee mug to fill up and walk all the way home to feed his family. And unbelievable. They find people dead, laying up against trees in this area where they've had malnutrition. They just sit to rest and they die because there's so much malnutrition. Children that are 6 years old raising babies because the parents aren't either, they're not there or they're dead and there's nobody to take care of them. There is one orphanage in this area. Next slide. The people are the Maasai warriors, which they have cousins in the same tribe that are in Kenya. And cattle is about prestige. It's not about raising cattle to sell them and make a living. It's about how many cattle do you have so you have prestige. So what they do is they eat the dead and sickly cattle, and they keep all the rest of them. So they're trying to change that culture. Many beautiful things about their culture, both cultures. The women in the Karamojong do everything. The men do nothing except they're warriors. And they go out with their warring parties, and that's what they do. So they're trying to teach them to farm. Teach them to raise crops to feed themselves. And it's starting to catch on. Sam has, we purchased 60 acres. They have tilled up the 60 acres. They've planted beans in 60 acres. Very, very, very fertile land. Amazing what they can grow. The maize that they grow, it'll be 7 or 8 feet tall with weeds 2 feet tall all the way through it, or they'll grow something alongside of the maize, and it'll be full cobs. I mean, just beautiful crops because it's so fertile. But they don't manage it right. It looks like a desert out there, but it's not. It's amazing. And so he's taking that and teaching them. It's called the Manyata Project, and they're trying to buy a tractor to help till people's land so they can start growing their own food, so they can stop people from starving, and all the while sharing the word of the Lord and having Bible studies and bringing people to Jesus. It's pretty amazing. Next slide. We brought 100 pounds of seeds with us in our luggage, and shared that with the people in the Atesso region and the Karamoja region. So that was a pretty impactful thing for them. Next slide. The women, again, work really hard. I just wanted to show you how hard the women work. They do laundry outside and in bowls. They cook outside over open flames. When they want to make something, if something's cooling off on one side of the pot, they literally take the wood out and slide it over to that side to heat up that side of the pot. I don't know how they cook that way. We just can't imagine how many hours it takes for these women to prepare a meal. They start early before the sun comes up, and they don't quit until after the sun goes down. Everything they do is, next slide, is just unbelievable. They haul all their water. Some do have charcoal stove, hard to see, but in the center of the picture, in the back by the wall, is a little charcoal stove. Those yellow containers are what they haul all their water in. You'll see a bike going down the road with a six-year-old child, and there'll be, you know, two jerry cans on the back, and they'll have one hanging off of the front, and they're hauling water miles back home. They don't drink their water unless they boil it. It's very dangerous with bacteria and other disease. But they all have pride in their work. Next slide. That woman on the left, she's hauling firewood. It's not a man hauling firewood. It's not a man chopping down a tree and cutting the firewood and splitting it. It's a woman. She's the one that's doing that. Next slide. One thing the younger generation of men is trying to do is some of them see the importance of coming alongside their women and their wives more. And so we had a discipleship training, and it became about knowing who you are, knowing where you're strong in the Lord, but honoring and loving your wife. And Dr. Paul led this, and he proposed this question to all of them. He said, if you were convicted of loving your wife, would you be found guilty in a court of law? That was an impactful statement for a lot of them. They had never thought about that before. And we heard that over and over and over from the people that were there at this discipleship training, that it just, they thought about it, and the men and women came together and they started talking about how they could better serve their wives, how their wives could better serve their husbands, because it's both ways. Next slide. When it came to the agriculture, there was a ministry called Shepherding the Pearl, which is a brilliant name for a ministry. There's a scripture in Matthew. It says the kingdom of heaven is like treasure or a pearl buried in a field that a man found and reburied. Then in his joy, he goes and sells everything he has and buys that field. Put everything in on that. Gets rid of everything else, puts everything on that. Because the pearl, the kingdom of heaven, is the most important thing that we'll ever have. And these guys are trying to make people understand that through their agriculture ministry, which is fascinating. The kingdom's worth giving everything up. These guys have an entrepreneurial spirit. There's three of them. They are all in doing totally different things for their businesses. They're growing crops differently. They're using cattle that are, you know, better breeds of cattle that they can sell, not just use for prestige. They're trying to take 30 young Ugandans and empower them with this knowledge. One of the guys is an agronomist, and he's a very knowledgeable agronomist. And he and I had a lot of great conversations. These guys could take the world and they could own it in this area. They literally have, they've got the plan to be able to take over agriculture in that area. But they want to share it with everyone else because they see the importance of how it's going to change their culture and better the people. And when they come to the farm and they have these tours, next slide, they share all of this and show everyone. They don't hold any secrets back. That's Emma, he's the agronomist. And just a beautiful snapshot of how we all should be when it comes to this stuff. I think that's just, it's brilliant. Next slide. These are just some of the, they have value-added egg where they've, you know, their cattle will produce milk and then they make yogurt and they sell it at a local market. Nobody does that. There are no grocery stores. There is no deep freeze. The deep freeze, I was just telling a couple people out here, the deep freeze is the pig running around on the ground. You know, it's the chickens that are outside in the yard. You know, that's their deep freeze. So when you make the yogurt, they can't refrigerate it. There's no power. There's no, you know, grid, power grid. So they have to sell it immediately. So they've done all the work entrepreneurially for that. I will tell you that the yogurt is a very good laxative. I was not used to it. I had a hard time that day. It's delicious stuff. But brilliant marketing strategies. They're making all kinds of different things and teaching people how you take care of yourself. Next slide. These are some of the things that we all did together. And so we brought 100 pounds of seeds. That was from Albuquerque. We completed a fence around Barnack School. That was the monies that you guys gave, the things that we did together. People were breaking into the school and stealing the students' things. We built a fence around that. There's a solar system where they had a hard time charging a cell phone. They have cell phones. They're not like our cell phones, but they have cell phones. Couldn't even charge a cell phone on the battery that they use for their school. And they have to use a computer at the school to take state tests and assessments. So that's a very challenging thing. So we help them with that solar system. The tailoring ministry received fabric. We bought foodstuffs for someone to eat for a year. That would be the nutritious stuff that I talked about earlier. We rented Sam Abuku's place so he can continue his ministry there because he ran out of money. He didn't have enough money for rent. So he'll be able to stay for at least another year and do the work that he's doing with the people in Karamoja. And we assisted in purchasing the 30 acres that's now been broken up and all planted into beans so they have protein to feed people in the hospital. If you go to the hospital, you don't eat. Most hospitals do not have food. Most people do not go to the hospital when they're sick because they starve to death. So Sam is in the hospital cooking food for these people and providing a means for them to stay healthy and share the word with them. Remember this, says 2 Corinthians, the person who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. And the person who sows generously will also reap generously. We've been very generous. I am so thankful. I've said so many times over and over that I'm so thankful for how generous all of you have been. Thank you for sharing with these people. Next slide. So I think as far as wrapping it up, we have a top priority in our lives, which is reaching. You don't have to go to Uganda. You don't have to go to Russia or Ukraine. You can go right here, and you can do all kinds of things and reach so many people. Remember, all these people are God's kids. It would be so easy to look at the Karamoja and say, let them do what they want to do and let them die because they act that way. We know that's not the right thing to do. These are God's kids. All the nations need to hear. And so God provides opportunities for all of us to pour in however we want to. However we feel led to is the best way to say that. The Spirit will lead you. 1 Corinthians says, for if I preach the gospel, I have no reason to boast because an obligation is placed on me. And woe to me if I do not preach the gospel. Spiritual conversations. Reach out. Make a difference. But don't put it on you. Remember, it's not about you. It's about God doing the work. It just takes so much pressure off. Next slide. So in the bulletin, there's an insert. It's a very complex insert. I'll be speaking more about this in the future. This is here so you understand a little bit about where you might be able to give if you're led to. There is no condemnation or guilt if you are not led to do anything. God is going to tell you what you need to do. And so there will be specifics later. I'll be sharing with you some of the students that we can support with scholarships. You can give to Karamoja. You can help them feeding people. This is something for you to pray about, to look at. If you have any questions about it, please ask. I didn't want to just talk about money because that's not what it's all about. It's about the heart, and it's about pouring into wherever you're led to do that. All of this will happen in January because that's when they start school. And so I want to thank you. I want to thank you for supporting me, for supporting the Ugandan mission, for sending us to Uganda to do this work, to bring this back, to share with you, to wherever it might spread in the future. It's exciting to think about that. I might even get to go talk to other churches. I don't know. But it's just fantastic time. That we can do a lot of good. And I pray you all receive a blessing for all that you have done, for your generosity, for serving the Lord, and I ask that you would search out for ways that you might be able to do something that has to do with reaching others. But remember, the last thing is to God be the glory. It's not us. Let's pray. Lord God, thank you for this message, Lord. I ask that everybody is impacted however you want them to be impacted, Father. That the scripture reached out to those who needed to hear the scripture, that their hearts are open for future opportunities to serve your kingdom, to be faithful followers of you, Christ. In your name we all pray. Amen.
Amen. That is exciting. Yes, give the Lord a clap offering for what he's doing. I want to know if I look like Gabe or I went like this and went, ooh. I feel you, brother. It's good. Let's stand together and sing our closing hymn. Hymn number 559, Here I Am, Lord.
Thank you.
And quickly before we have our benediction, I just want to let you know we do still have seats available for the Dakota Hope Banquet next week. If you were interested in attending that banquet, please see Callie. She'll give you all the information you need. Now let us receive our benediction together in unison found in the bulletin. Now on to the one God, our only God, who saves us through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, honor, and dominion, as it was in the beginning, to this time, forevermore. Amen.